Good morning. Good morning to you. I hope all is well today. God bless you this morning. I have been in worship this morning. I am so excited. I feel good. I got my little Christmas tree up. And yeah, so I am a little tardy, but I am so pumped today. I rested okay, and I knew what I was going to be talking about this week, and so I have been praying and preparing, and I had to get my hype man, you know, my hype woman in my head, so I put on one of my favorite shirts. I get it, guacamole, I'm extra too, and I'm extra, so we're just going to be our extra self today, and so I am so excited about this teaching this week. Listen, this is like something I have never done before. And I'll tell you, like one of my pastors says, today is the most important word you will ever hear from me at this point. This is the most important thing I've ever preached. And the reason is because the plan of salvation is one of the first things not only do we or perform as Christians with others who are coming into the kingdom of God, but the plan of salvation is also one of the first things that we teach those in the kingdom of God. And so we've been messing it up, y'all, and I had some feelings, some thoughts, some considerations about that in my life, a long life's journey. I've wondered, I've prayed, I've studied, and I found some things out this week in this study. And I said, Lord, my people are not going to want to hear this today. Me messing with their plan of salvation. People don't like when you mess with their religion. But I'd like to suggest today that I am doing just that. I am messing with your religion. But I'm not messing with your kingdom citizenship. I'm not messing with who you are in Christ. If anything is good, God did it. And so for us to be planners, for us to be steadfast, I believe that that is the Lord's will for us to make plans. I think that God has planted desires in our heart, and we sit around and we wait and we wait and we wait for God to bring those plans to come to pass. But the truth of the matter is, he has given us the world to have dominion. So we need to come up with the plan. It is a tad different when it comes to the concept and the ideas of the plan of salvation. So with that being said, I have been in worship already this morning, y'all. And listen, I don't know that I can do it like I did it before, but I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to sing a little bit of I Cried My Last Tear Yesterday, because I feel that that's what happens in the act of salvation. When people come to Christ, whether they're babies, children, teenagers, young adults, real grown adults, grown adults, middle-aged adults, old, whatever their status is, however old they are, there are always tears being shed. And to know that no matter how many more tears drop from your eyes, that God has already fixed all of that. That the last time you cried was the last time you were going to cry, at least in the sense of not feeling connected to the source and not feeling connected to the power of God. That is an achievement. That is something that is bigger than an achievement. That is something that we cannot do on our own. Only the reconciliation in Christ and the movement of the Holy Spirit in our life and the transformation and growth that comes from the Holy Spirit can let us have the confidence and the boldness to tell people who are listening and maybe not even listening, listen, I cried my last tear yesterday, because I have figured out that anything that happened to me that was good, God did it. And so, yeah. Yeah, it's just, anyway, I hope I don't get too tongue-tied today, because I haven't been in the spirit a while. And let me just tell you, if you're going to be speaking to people, you better get in the spirit before you speak to them. So I'm going to sing, and then we're going to pray, and we're going to get right into this today. I cannot tell you how long it's going to take, but I do plan on taking my time. So I hope you can listen to it all. And if not, you can definitely get it on the rewind, because it's just eating me up. The spirit just eating me up this morning. All right. So let me get this going. Now, listen, I'm not a Clarksville stan, I'm not either one of the Marys, but I can sing a little bit of Yesterday. I've had enough heartache and enough headache. I've had so many ups and downs. Don't know how much more I can take. So I decided that I cried my last tear Yesterday. Either I'm gonna trust you, or I may as well walk away. 'Cause stressing don't make it better. Don't make it better, no way. See, I decided that I cried my last tears yesterday. Yesterday. Oh. Hallelujah. Woo! Let me just tell you, God is good. You understand? I mean, that is just a powerful testimony of faith. When you can tell the world, when you can tell the saints, you can tell your neighbor, you can tell your spouse, your children, you know what? I cannot let y'all worry me because God's already delivered me from that. So, let's pray about it. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you wipe all of our tears away. We thank you for allowing us to approach your throne of grace once again. Now, God, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. You are our strength and redeemer. And Lord, let there be none of me and all of you. And we'll be careful to honor and praise you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Ooh, just make me feel so good on the inside. Thank you, Father. All right, so let's talk about the plan of salvation. So, my subtitle is, and how we've been messing it up. And I think it's important to remember that when we talk about a plan, that we understand how we define plan and how we define salvation. But before we get into that and we get into scripture, I want to show you something. I remember leaflets as a small child, as well as a young adult in college, and then subsequently in divinity school. They gave us these plans to share with people. We got them in Sunday school. We got them as missionaries on campus when I was in divinity school and learning systematic theology and how to carry out the things of the church and how to make programs and how to create worship scripts and all of this stuff that we had to learn how to do. This was a part of it all. And if you notice, it's very succinct, and it, even though these are all slightly different, they all explain the plan of salvation that generally most of us have learned. Okay, so one thing I can say about my education, and I'm not just speaking about my university education, but just being educated in the church, at least the church was consistent, right? Okay, so you got the sinful man on this side and the holy God on this side, and you got this bridge to Jesus Christ. So it always makes you feel like filthy rags. That's what my Uncle Charles says. You're just filthy rags, right? And then over here is God and this eternal life. And you think to yourself the whole time, well, why in the world would God put me in this kind of position? You know, it's just an off-putting image. It seems like a plank. Seems like a plank, right? And I watch American Gladiator all the time. I love American Gladiator. I think about American Gladiator when I think of this plan of salvation that has been presented to us, this plan of salvation that we have been equipped with to share with believers. Now, I have a love and appreciation for this because I have grown and I understand this model, but I also understand that there are people in the world who would be intimidated by this, right? It seems very corrective. It seems like I'm going to be walking out on something different. Now, you want me to relinquish my good works, my religion, and you want me to have some type of moment of morality, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So these verses here talk about Christ. And then this verse right here talks about what your state is, basically what your status is. If you're not in Christ, you a sinner, and you need to be, you know, you fallen short of the glory of God. Excuse me. So here we come down here and it says sin is what separates us from God. And so it's offering this chair, I guess. I don't know. But you still got to get through the plank, right? Okay. So that's where we lose people a lot of times, because we paint the picture of God as walking a plank. Now, the Christian walk or the kingdom walk is one that the road does get narrow, but it doesn't get narrow because of the decisions and choices we make. It gets narrow because after accepting Christ, the working of the Holy Spirit causes us to tighten our life up, right? It's a big difference between doing good to get good and doing good because God is good. And so this just demonstrates a lot of work. You want me to believe in a God that I can't see. You want me to walk a plank, basically like an American gladiator, and then I'm supposed to just hope it all works out. That's not exactly what God is saying, right? Okay, so let's talk about it today. Let's get it clear the air and get it all out in the open. So, Romans, the 10th chapter, in verses 8 through 10, New King James Version, say, but what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth, in your heart. That is the word of faith, which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So, this is very clear, right? We get this in this Pauline letter, and we understand that that there must be a confession made, and that we must believe in our heart, which is really our mind, right? That God has been raised from the dead, Jesus Christ, and we shall be saved. And it takes a lot of, this particular translation takes a lot of cognitive adjustment, because a lot of people feel like they don't need to be saved. They feel like they just need some adjustments in their life, right? Well, in part, that is true. In part, getting someone to understand that they're failing, like you're starting out telling people that, listen, you need God because you're failing. And they're looking at you like, no, I make good money. No, I'm not exactly failing. I wouldn't say fail. Well, you need reconciliation because you sin. No, I don't know. I don't know. Your Bible says a lot about sin, but I don't. You need to tease that out for me a little bit more, because, you know, what you call sin, it could be a lot of different things. And so we began to lose people in the process because of all this rigmarole, because of all this tatteredness and this plank that we have created. Christ has not created. Christ did not put this. He did not create this picture. This is man-made. So let's tease out some things. All right. What is a plan? And we're going to go based on dictionary definition, Webster. You can look it up online. We're just going to go with a basic definition. And I want to use a basic definition because I believe it is the basic definition is the way that we understand plan. All right. Plan, by definition, is a detailed proposal for doing or achieving something. However, why would God's people need to plan salvation? In that salvation is not an accolade or an achievement. Therefore, having a detailed proposal on how to do it or obtain it turns many off. Okay, so I said a lot there. Plan, by definition, is a detailed proposal for doing or achieving something. So when we approach salvation or being reconciled back to Christ as a plan, we view it and we teach it and others embrace it as achieving something. And salvation is not something that you achieve. Okay. It's not an accolade. It's not something you put under your belt. Well, you know what? Now I got saved. I can check that off my list. It doesn't exactly work that way. You don't have to have a proposal for salvation. You don't have to even embrace a proposal for salvation. Christ has already saved us. He already's done it. So planning it in that sense is actually opposite of what God meant. My experience with the plan of salvation in the sense that it was taught to me was, number one, it's restricting. Okay. What we actually receive is not restriction. It's not walking a plank. It's freedom. That is polar opposite of what we've been taught. We've been taught you get in Christ and you walk this narrow road. And then we start hearing people talk about freedom, right? And that, you know, Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And that is 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter and the 17th verse. Now the Lord is Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Now stop sinning. That's what we tell people. We begin to put restrictions. And you think about a restriction on your airway and how that would feel. Can you imagine that the God that has breathed breath in us, that would he would restrict us and make us feel some type of restraint upon pulling us into his kingdom, into his arms, into his bosom? No, no. We need to get to the freedom part first. We need to stop telling people, listen, you need to tighten your life up. You need to stop sinning. You need to accept Christ. I got this when I was serving in ministry, and I knew something wasn't quite right about it, but I couldn't put my finger on it. So there was this model, this training, that if you had accepted Christ early in life as a child or a young adult, and you got baptized, but you didn't understand what that meant, you needed to be baptized again, which is the most unbiblical thing I have ever heard of. Now, I am Baptist, and I know people have a lot of feelings about Baptists, but my baptism was so sacred at the age of 8 that I can never imagine rewriting my script and convincing myself and anyone else that my baptism that I had as a child did not take. It really roughed my spirit up. And when my loved ones, people I was related to, or my friends would come and they would accept Christ, I would overhear people evangelizing to them and in some ways proselytizing and telling them to abandon their history. And what I like about God is all things work together for the good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. So you don't go telling people to abandon everything that they have experienced along life's journey as if everything they experienced didn't matter to God. If it mattered to God, it should matter to us. So I never could understand that restrictive mindset that if you didn't have the understanding, when God calls us as little children. Now, sometimes we don't have the leadership in our life to help us to understand that God is calling us, because as leaders and as parents and as stakeholders in the lives of children, what we end up doing is trying to have power over them instead of empower them. So this is a very powerful teaching that God has shown me. And I understand specifically that we cannot rewrite people's history. We can start right where they are and pick up where God was already in their life. They didn't meet us and meet Jesus and, you know, we started their life over again. Jesus did that. So not only my experience with the plan of salvation became restricted, but it became auto-correcting. Like, you know, when you type a text or a post and it auto-corrects your word. Well, that's not exactly how reconciliation in Christ works. What we receive from Christ has already been corrected. So you don't have to start acting like your phone and auto-correcting people or letting people think that, well, you know, now you can do this and now you can stop doing that. The Holy Spirit is a internal autocorrector. And we came as a package with everything we needed to survive. When we were created in our mother's womb, we were thought about at the very beginning of time. So even before we were a creation, we were already in the plan. God already had a purpose for our life. So we need to stop allowing that idea of you need to get baptized again or you need to rededicate. Listen, I'm in Christ and, you know, I'm not perfect, but God is able. And every day I wake up is a rededication. And so we use these things in religion as Christians to restrict our brothers and sisters and have power and dominion over them instead of empowering them to have dominion over this earth that God has given us. Yes, Holy Spirit, I received that. Thank you, Father. So I wanted to mention before I move on to the last piece, Zechariah 9:9. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having a salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." Yes, this is Zechariah. This is Old Testament. So it lets me know that I don't need to put my auto-correcting hands in the lives of people. It had already been prophesied that Jesus was coming. Jesus has already made everything available in his finished works. So if I visualize and I imagine Christ coming in humbly as he did, and it was prophesied, why on earth would I ever want to make anybody feel like what they did in the past has to be redone in order to make them whole? So I'm getting ahead of myself, as I normally do. That takes me to the third piece of my experience with the plan of salvation, in that it is an achievement, when honestly, that's not how it works. It's not an achievement. It's what we do to accept wholeness. Isn't that something? It's an acceptance of what has already been done. It's basically the equivalent of all the paperwork has been drawn out, and you take an opportunity to sign it and make it official in your own life, because it's already official with Christ. So yes, we have been made whole. And so now that we've defined what a plan is, let's talk about what is salvation. Salvation, by definition, means preservation or deliverance from harm, ruin, or loss. However, we find that in the Bible, the Greek word for salvation is soteria. Soteria is used several places in the Bible with slightly varying meanings, none of which are based directly on how we cognitively conceive salvation or this definition of preservation of harm, ruin, or loss. Truly, what it means is to make whole, to save, to heal, to be kept whole, to make complete. This is why I'd like to suggest, instead of using the plan of salvation, which is more like achieving preservation, we should consider using a more accurate conception of accepting wholeness when we share the gospel of Christ. The world wants acceptance, not a plan. The world wants wholeness, not preservation. Self-preservation is almost like a self-cleaning oven. It comes a part of the package. But wholeness does not necessarily come as a part of the package, or otherwise we would not always be seeking. Is it processed, and is Christ our deliverer in that process, right? It's a process. Yes, however, I don't want you to think I am mimicking words or mincing words with you today. I'm not. I would never do that, because words matter, okay? And the misuse of language hinders the progress of the church and our role in the soul-winning aspects of the kingdom of God. The world understands with greater clarity on how God's kingdom system of reconciliation works. Accepting wholeness is a better concept, which is why certain groups use wholeness as a means of allure and engagement. You ever think about that? How certain groups will allure our children into engagement with the idea of wholeness, that I will accept you completely, and we can't get them to pick up a Bible. We can't even read a verse to them, because they're offering something that actually is the correct way to view kingdom access. And so this is why I believe, and the word says it, that the world has a better concept of dominion. The world has a better concept of progress than the people of God, than the people of light. Accepting wholeness is a better concept, which is why certain groups use wholeness as a means of allure and engagement. If you have ever asked the question, why did she choose that lifestyle? Or what would make him get involved with a gang? How could they decide to be connected to something that goes against our family values and our work ethic? One word. Wholeness. People want to accept wholeness. We were created to be whole and not saved in our way of thinking. We know it is not working either, because instead of sharing Christ with others, these days we often get sad and empathetic, thinking, if they only knew Christ, or how are they living without Christ? It will never get better for them. But see, the world has decided to take God up on his offer. The world is looking for wholeness. Wholeness is part of the reconciliation process. Let me show you how I know the world knows better than the church these things. Luke 16 and 8, and I'm going to read it in the New King James Version. This is coming straight out of the mouth of Christ, okay? So the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. Luke 16 and 9. And I say to you, make friends for yourself by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. Now, I know you have to be thinking, okay, that's not how I read that. But that is exactly what it says. It is saying that the world is more shrewd with the kingdom pieces and the kingdom tools that God has given than those who are in the light, those who have received salvation, those who have been accepting of wholeness. Because they don't understand it as accepting wholeness, people of the light, sons and daughters of the light, view it as a plan of salvation instead of accepting wholeness. And that's what the world wants. The world wants to be made whole. And so we're actually taught in the word to look at the world and its systems and how it makes money and how it, now it doesn't say worship like the world worships, but it says there is value in the way that the world does things, because the world understands God's system. Why does it seem like we are not saving folks like we used to? Why do the rich get richer and the poor get poorer? Why are those who are sons of the light, sons meaning women and men, brothers and sisters who know Christ, gaining more in the world? Why are they not gaining more? Because the world is using God's principles. People understand kingdom wealth and citizenship. Wholeness sells. You ever heard of the idea that sex sells? Well, wholeness sells. This is the difference from being incomplete to complete. This is why when people are looking for a significant other, they don't just look for a warm body. They are looking for a soulmate, because they want to be whole. When people strive in education, career advancement, and accolades, they are searching for one thing, wholeness, to fulfill their purpose. And when people seek success, they are really seeking to be viewed and appreciated as valuable. Going through the plan of salvation can be petty and regressive. Individuals receive judgment first and are offered wholeness as a byproduct. God's kingdom is the other way around. The Christian disciplines are second to wholeness. Once whole, the disciplines can be embraced as the Holy Spirit is doing the work, as we are his workmanship. Your relatives don't want to enlist in the army. They want rest. They want wholeness. But the truth is, the world still is not whole. So it's kind of a very weird and ironic juxtaposition that even though the world understands the system and seeks the wholeness, they don't have the wholeness if they don't have the reconciliation of Christ. They want wholeness, but the truth is they're not whole. But they have a better idea of wanting wholeness than those in the kingdom of God. So, to end today, I'm going to walk through Christian disciplines. I want us to think about the disciplines we use in our life. I have lots of friends and family members who use the Christian disciplines, spiritual disciplines, to tighten their life, right? To get a revelation from God, to understand what their purpose is and to carry it out every day, to be a person of value in the lives of the people that they're connected to in their community and their homes. And the disciplines help get us there, right? They help shape our life. In fact, if it were not for the spiritual disciplines, I would not be able to get up every morning, Monday through Friday, and preach the word that God has given me and do a teaching that I believe is put in my spirit by the word of God. However, if I had not first been made whole, these would all be just sinking sand. Only what you do for Christ will last. So you can do good to get good, but it's only because God is good that good is reciprocal in our lives. That what we sow, we will reap. Not exactly what we sow, and not exactly where we sow, but we will reap what we are to have, because that is the economics of God's kingdom. So I want you to just shift your mind slightly, okay? Now, meditation. Meditation is a beautiful art. Eastern meditation has mastered that thing. They are brilliant in the art of meditation, of catapulting one's mind into a place of rest and of peace and of soundness, where an individual can settle their spirit, okay? But the truth is, you can meditate all day. You can use all the understandings of Hindu and Buddhism, and you can engage into Muslim meditation 3 times a day, depending on where the sun is. But if you've not been made whole, it's just like sinking sand. It's just like blades of grass. It is the wholeness that people need and they want. Prayer. Prayer is good. Jesus prayed until he bled. He sweat blood. So prayer is a vital part of a component of this walk in the kingdom. As a Christian, it's very important to pray and seek God's face, to turn from our ways. But the turning from our ways happens as a result of the movement of the Holy Spirit. And the movement of the Holy Spirit happens because we have been made whole. Solitude. I love solitude. Solitude is one of the disciplines that I have to be careful with, because I think I appreciate it more than any. I like being alone. I just do. I find a lot of value in it. But there are times when even I have practiced solitude and I know that I need to move away from that discipline, because there is this such a peace and such a deadness that sometimes my spirit goes too far into that. And right underneath solitude can be sadness if you're not careful. But one thing I have learned about solitude as a discipline, as long as I have my wholeness in Christ, I know that God will put a holy rope around my legs and pull me out just in the nick of time, because that's the God we serve. He never lets us go so far in a discipline that we can't pull ourselves through. Submission. Women submit to men. Men submit to women. We submit on our jobs. We submit things that we need to improve our life, right? If we need to increase the value of our home, we have to submit paperwork to the homeowners association. And then sometimes we have to make sure our kids submit their work. Then there's this concept of submission and resigning. Let me just tell you, that is not a spiritual discipline that anybody should enter in if they are not whole. To submit to another individual or an institution and not be whole is really the definition of insanity. Doing the same thing, the same way, and expecting a different result. If you go into a situation incomplete and not whole, and you submit What you're really saying is, I need this person, I need this institution to make me whole. So, again, it is the wholeness that we are seeking after. Fasting. I have some friends that are doing intermittent fasting. I am a faster. I have been fasting a long time, more than 20 years now. I remember one time myself and my accountability partner decided to fast. And oh my God, we were so hungry by, like, I want to say it might have been a 3 to 5 day fast. And it wasn't a complete fast. It, you know, we could drink liquids and juice and things like that. But ultimately, we were done. We were hungry. And we went to, I think it was Ruby Tuesday, and ordered up a whole bunch of food. And my mother had put a little bit of money in my account. And they went to go swipe that thing, and it was not approved. So we started praying, right? Because we know that we've been made whole in Christ, and we know that God would not allow us to get in this situation without figuring out how to get out. Like, Lord, you know, you allowed this, but we know we got ourselves in this situation, God. But it is the wholeness in Christ that got us out. And two of our mentors walked in the door just at that moment. And I mean, they laughed at us. They laughed at us for about an hour that we were foolish enough to go out to eat, and we knew we didn't have no money. But that's what I mean. When you're fasting and when you're praying, when you're seeking God through a spiritual discipline, if you are not already whole, meaning if you enter that fast seeking wholeness, you're going to be messed up. When you fast, what you're really doing is resigning a part of your body and your mind and your heart to God, that He may fill that space up. Not because He hasn't already created you whole, but because He is fashioning us. And fashioning something is different from whole. When we get a bolt of material, we get a whole piece, we get a whole dress. But when we fashion that material, we get a beautiful dress to come out of it. Was the dress whole in the material? Yes, it was. But when we tightened it up, it became something that looked more pleasing to the eye. Study, simplicity, service. These are all things that we do as disciplines, that the world does as disciplines. They are masters of it. Simplicity. I don't need all this stuff. I can do with less. But if you end up with less and you're not whole in Christ, then you're still going to be seeking less or less or more less. Because you think that less is going to lead you somewhere, but it's not. It's just a discipline. And you can't get disciplines until you're whole. Confession. People say confession is good for the soul. Yeah, okay, that's a great proverb. But you know what? If you confess and you're not already whole, what is the point of confession? Really, the true meaning and purpose in confession is to release from your spirit what has been binding you, so that you can lay aside every weight that besets you. Because Jesus is not about weight. He's not about putting weight on you. He's about taking weight off of you. So even in the act of confession, it's not about us. It's already about what Jesus has already done. He's already reconciled you. He's already forgiven you from your sins. You're catching up on Jesus. The last three, worship, guidance, and celebration. Worship is certainly a spiritual discipline. It is a Christian discipline that puts you in contact with the Almighty. Now, if we come in contact with the Almighty without the understanding that the Almighty has already done the work, that the worship experience is a dwelling, an indwelling, so that we can experience God at a higher level. In education, we try to get students to understand what it means to have higher level thinking skills, meaning when you look at this passage, or when you look at this word problem, or when you consider this scientific development or this time in history, what could be there that is not in the words? What are you overhearing? How can you think higher? Worship takes us higher. It takes us into another plane with God. But as a kingdom person, as someone who has been reconciled in Christ, your worship is like a dance. It's like a back and forth, this meaningful moment with you and God. And sometimes we cry, and sometimes we laugh, and sometimes we speak in a heavenly language. And all of that is worship. But to be seeking to be made whole when you've already been made whole since the beginning of time in worship is going to be, once again, sinking sand. Guidance and celebration. Guidance is something we all need. To seek guidance as a discipline requires a tight life. It requires for us to really figure out what we're looking after. What is guiding us? Sometimes that's a person, a mentor. Other times that is revelation in the Word of God. But we can't seek to be whole with guidance. I can't expect my mentor to make me whole. I have to come to her whole, and I bring my wholeness to her. This is such as I have. This is the allotment that Christ gave me. It's my wholeness. What can we do with it? What can we do to pull out the purpose, the calling? How can I become a person of value with the guidance that you can give me? And last, celebration. Let me tell you, there is no greater love that people receive from us than when we celebrate them, when we call them on their birthday, when we remember them, when they think, how out of all the people that you know, could you remember me? Or all the things that you have to do, would you even take time in your day? However, when we experience celebration as a means of wholeness, meaning we have to have a birthday party, or we have to have some type of, you know, soiree, and this soiree is going to make me whole. This soiree is going to show everybody who I am. Listen, if you don't get all of who I am right now, you are not going to get it in a celebration, because I'm probably going to be tired. I'm probably going to look my best, not my true self, but I probably would have put on some stuff. And in that celebration process, yes, we are to glorify God. And yes, we are to have a good time. And God wants us to celebrate each other. He needs for us to do that. But we can't find our wholeness in being celebrated. And we can't find our wholeness in celebrating others. It is a good thing to do. But remember, we don't do good to get good. We do good because God is good. So, with that being said, I am done. And that's how we've been messing it up. So let's see if we can get it fixed up tomorrow. Okay, let's talk about how we can get it fixed up in the lives of others. What are we going to bring to the table in the midst of social media and political attacks that we can't control? How are we going to commandeer the situation with wholeness and empower our children with something beyond what they can search on Google? That's a challenge, right? I don't have all the answers, but God has given me some insight about some things that, guess what? Jesus saves. He's still reconciling souls. He's still doing the hard work. We're just available to Him, to be used by Him. So I don't want you to be discouraged today. I don't want you to think because the systems that we have been taught are faulty that God's system has stopped working. It hasn't. Let me pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your plan, your strategic priorities for our life. But more importantly, we thank you for accepting us unconditionally. We try to live unconditional, God, but anything we are able to do that's unconditional is through you. You've made us whole. And we know that we have brothers and sisters in the world, our neighbors, our friends, our family members, our sisters and brothers, our mothers and fathers, our children, who don't know you and the pardon that you have offered to reconcile us back to God. We know, Jesus, that it is well with our soul. But God, we just need a better way of executing it. So Lord, as we go into this season to celebrate your birth, give us what we should pray. Your word says that you don't know how to pray. I can give you some words to pray. And as we pray for those who are out there that seem to have more access in every way and be seeking wholeness in every way than what we have to offer, we know that anything that happens to us that is good, God did it. So it is that wholeness that we offer. So Lord, as we go throughout this week, show us, keep us in your care, and we'll be careful to honor you as we seek a better way to help others understand their wholeness in Christ. We love you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Whew, that was a little more comprehensive than what I expected, but God is good. Isn't the Holy Spirit awesome? Even the things that I had not planned to say, he implanted them in my heart. And I pray that you receive it today. So have a good one. Enjoy your break. God is for you. Jesus is with you. The Holy Spirit is in you, and all of heaven's angels are on your side. Have a good day. God bless you.